I would like to immediately proceed on to hearing from a number of other stakeholder groups in this process, beginning with the California State Lands Commission. And we'll do a slight modification here in that since we have no question period at the end of this session, we will have questions for a limited period after each speaker, trying to stay on time. Please proceed.
Okay, thank you. I'm Jen Mattox. I'm the science advisor and tribal liaison at the California State Lands Commission. And we were asked to be here to just provide our perspective as the legal, at least those are the state legally recognized sovereign land owner of the lake. But I say it that way because, you know, in this particular instance, as with all land in California, these are not our lands. These are lands that were taken and that are now under legal recognition as owned by us as a public agency, but we all know that we belong to the land and they were originally inhabited by people long before us. So let's say it that way. I'm the science advisor. I'm in the executive office. And I want to explain a little bit about the public trust. And I'll try to be straightforward, but I have a lot of opinions about a lot of stuff that was said today. So I took some notes and I'll try to not like veer off too much. So a lot of land, not very much visibility. So we're sort of the quiet state agency. The State Lands Commission is responsible to manage, pursuant to the common law public trust doctrine, you know, millions of acres of tide submerged land. That's the off the coast from the mean high tide line to the 3 nautical mile mark, and the beds of navigable waterways, including major rivers and highlighted lakes. I won't speak about it in this presentation, although there are some of these in the Owens Lake area and in the Owens Valley. We also have ownership over a surface mineral. Those are school lands that we manage differently than our public trust lands, but that's all I'm going to say about that. So has anybody not heard of public trust doctrine or the State Lands Commission? No, everybody's cool. Okay, so we're the sovereign landowner. We're the land and resource manager. We hold all of these lands in trust for all of the people of the state. So think about that. That's really important related to some of the comments that were made. So even though we're going out to end today, I want to really impress this concept. The common law public trust doctrine for the benefit of all of the people of the state and in the best interest of the state. This comes over from English common law, the idea that the tide submerged lands that are there for all of the people for commerce, navigation, and fisheries, they can't be sold into private ownership or alienated is the word we use for it. We cannot alienate these lands. And we cannot allow uses or facilities or activities on these lands that would degrade those public trust values, resources, or uses, or would be incompatible with those. Over time, the courts, a couple of really important court decisions, including one up the road from Owens at Mono Lake, has expanded our understanding of the public trust. And so it's an evolving trust. It's a living thing. It's not static in time. So now we recognize the value of environmental protection, open space, recreation, access, and native and cultural rights on our land. So in this particular case, I'm really hoping that this presentation kind of ties together everything else, which is already kind of a mind bender with a lot of conflict, is that because of what you're going to understand about the public trust, kind of coming in contact with some of the really technical, intellectual, and academically rigorous sort of problem-solving approach, is that this is really going to need some very careful thought about adaptive and collaborative solutions that do not degrade the public trust values and do not degrade the public trust benefit that this lake provides to the people of the state. So at the lake, we have jurisdiction. Why? It's dry, right? Okay, well, so here's the Bessie Brady was a steamship that carried goods across the lake from the east side to the west side and back. The middle picture is Cerro Gordo mine. So people, they would bring charcoal on the Bessie Brady from the west side to the east side, unload that and carry products from the Cerro Gordo mine back across. So you can see that that's commercial navigation. It's dry now, but it still has the public trust. So it's kind of hard to understand about, well, why is it, you know, where was the state lands when this was happening? So the aqueduct was built in the early 1900s and was had dried the lake by 1913. The State Lands Commission was not formed until 1938. So the way that they looked, and prior to that, it was the surveyor general was all kind of like scandal and all this stuff, and it was, you know, put away for a while and nobody was minding the store, and then they kind of came back and provided this landowning agency and land stewardship agency. And the way that they looked at it was, you know, was it commercially navigable at the time of statehood? So it was, so it is. So what does this mean for public trust, commerce, navigation, fisheries? Nobody's going fishing on the lake right now. I mean, look at it, right? So what we do is we lease it now for a few different things, but we still have to find our leases not inconsistent or incompatible with public trust. So we have a lease with DWP, our main one. We've got a lot of other little ones, but the main one for the dust control project was issued in 1999. It was expired in April last month, but we've put a temporary holdover extension on that. And we've amended it 23 times because of the various phases, because of things that didn't work, emergencies, you know, all kinds of things. We're constantly working together. So you can see how close our relationship has to be with both Great Basin and also DWP. We have a couple of other lessees. U.S. Borax has a mineral lease, as well as some surface leases. They mine out of the brine pool, they mine some trona, stuff like that. And then I'm so glad that Jen put up that picture of the cow, because we've got some grazing leases there too. Other really important public trust uses there are recreational access, and then of course, I can't stress enough the value of this lake as wildlife habitat. It was mentioned earlier that that this is considered an important bird area of Audubon IVA. It was also last year designated as a hemispherically important Western Hemisphere Shorebird Reserve Network designation was placed over this. And if you think about the reason I keep coming back to context is we've seen a lot of change over time, a lot of human population, a lot of loss of other resources. So you can say that this isn't natural conditions. Owens in its natural state was not supporting birds, shorebirds, breeding birds the way that it does now, but we got to kind of let that go, because the fact is that now it does. Tens of thousands of shorebirds, diving ducks, dabbling ducks, breeding shorebirds, meadow species, and they now have collected here while other resources and places to stop over and breed have somewhat disappeared. So we can't just sort of say, oh, well, it's not a natural place for them anyway. So in our management of Owens Lake, and you'll see me also use its native name, Hatiada, which I hope is okay, and I just want to throw that out there as a measure of respect for its original name, to respect the people who have lived for, you know, over 10, 15,000 years along the shores of the lake as it grew and shrank. We should know and remember its original name. That management is complex. We've got dust blowing, but we've got cultural artifacts. We've got sand, we've got vegetation. So how do we apply the trust in this new context? And what I've put here is that it's really about collaborative management priorities. Public health and safety, that's pretty important. And we also have to do it because of the law. Protection and preservation of the habitat and environmental values I just spoke of a little bit. And then also respecting and protecting the native culture values and resources. And I'll hold myself back on that because the true experts are going to be speaking after me. But this area has a lot of meaning and culture and story, and it isn't something that we solve in here or in your lab or in your math equation. It's something that's a life. It's a living organism, and it needs to be solved with respect for the fact that it's complex. So, you know, thinking about sand fences, yeah, it's easy. You're saying, well, why would we do that instead of shreds? That's not public trust consistent. They are ugly. They degrade the aesthetics. They impede wildlife movement. They break apart. And so please, as my role in this briefing today is, when you think you have a good engineering solution, remember that the lake is an organism and it has to be managed pursuant to keeping the protections of the public trust alive. That's why I say sort of, we have to avoid this collision course. This is about balance. We know we're not gonna fill the lake back up and move all of the infrastructure. That's not realistic. We know we have legal dust control requirements. We know DWP wants to reduce the water use, but we also have these other uses and values and resources that also come into the equation. And so that's the role that I have here today, is to just go over that. And so I think that I have wanted to say about the sand fences, because that came up and I was like, well, because we wouldn't allow it. Just me, in the back of the room, I'll just say, hey. So, just those kinds of considerations when you're talking about chemical suppressants, sand fences, gravel. We have issued leases for gravel cover. It is a BAFM. It puts us in a bit of a pickle. But again, with the communication, coordination, we work it out, come up with creative ideas. And I will just close with saying, I'm always available if people need clarification on anything about what our requirements may or may not be, how we may or may not be responsive to something. And then I noticed from looking at everybody's bios, there is a ton of brain power in this room and on this panel, a lot of engineers, a lot of really high power intellectuals. And what I didn't see was, somebody's going to have to fake it, or everybody's going to have to kind of, you know, come to that, is I didn't see any anthropologists and I didn't see any traditional practice experts. And I would just encourage you to think about enlisting somebody who may have some knowledge. We have answers. We have people whose families and mothers and grandmothers and great-grandmothers have managed the resources here on the edge of the shoreline, and can provide a great deal of information, including the effect of the roots of the shrubs on the groundwater that inhibits the meadow grasses from growing and the use of traditional burn. So there are tools available to you beyond beyond some of these, what we all sort of grasp onto as traditional scientists. And I would just encourage you to explore those. Thanks.
Thank you. We have time for one or two questions. Any questions from the panel or on the phone?
And I tilt the room.
Okay. Thank you very much. So next we have Kathy Bancroft from the Tribal Historical, who's the Tribal Historical Preservation Officer for the Lone Pine and, excuse me if I do an incorrect pronunciation, Paiute-Shoshone Reservation.
Thank you. Manahu, Inani Ne Kathy Jefferson Bancroft, Numanu, Paiutinatawe, Nukimadu. First of all, I want to acknowledge the traditional landowners whose land we're on, the Tongva. And I don't know if I have any in the crowd here, usually I do, but I just want to thank them for allowing me to come down here to address you guys. We come from the land we call Paiahunaru, which means the place where the water always flows, ironically. And my family's lived there for thousands and thousands and thousands of years. We still live there and we care very deeply for this land. My grandmother, as a little girl, stood on the shores of Owens Lake and was told that she was going to live to see this lake dry. And they said, that will never happen, it's way too big. But she did. When she was young, the birds flew and blocked out the sun for days. And they thought you could never quit that. When I was young, the birds, there was a lot of birds flying over. You don't see that anymore. It's gotten a little better since they started putting water on the lake, but a lot of things have changed in our valley and affected our way of life. Because who we are is defined by the land we live on. Our cultural resources are not just the arrowhead that you saw up here, but they're all the plants, the animals, the water, the air, and that view you look at. There's stories about how all those mountains were formed. There's stories about every place in that valley, and that's who we are, and we are part of that story. We're part of this land. We take care of the land, and the land takes care of us. So when I look at these dust control measures, since that's what you're here for, every one of them are very disturbing because they are so destructive to the land. They can't implement any of these dust control measures without going through and wiping out every trace that my ancestors left on that land that show that we were there. They completely destroy the surface, the integrity, everything. What I've been on the lake all of my life. I've gone out there as a young child. I've gone out there to fish on the river. I've gone out to collect basket materials, collect foods, medicines, and everything, which got harder and harder the drier it got. I've gone out there later when it was dry. I've gone out since 2002. I've been on the lake in an official capacity representing the tribe as a tribal cultural monitor, and then as the Tribal Historic Preservation Officer. At first, they didn't talk to us a whole lot. We tried to save what we could by hiding stuff from the archaeologists. We didn't have a voice, but we still did everything we could to protect those resources. We don't believe that those resources belong to us, but it is our job to protect them because they still belong to the people that left us there. This land still needs to be protected from outsiders because we lived here for thousands of years and the land provided for all of us. Outsiders have been there for 150 years and have pretty much destroyed the place. When you look at the individual Backhams and what they've done as far as solutions to the dust mitigation. And I have to say, the Lone Pine Paiute-Shoshone Reservation is where I'm from. And our reservation was one of the reasons the lake was put into the project was implemented because of the dust. We all have really bad breathing problems. So we were really glad to see that something was being done about the dust, okay? So that we weren't against it or anything, but then as time went on, we could see the problems with the way things were carried out. They were looking at little individual postage stamp sized places that had a problem and trying to figure out how to deal with the dust in that area. You know, it's like, it's a big lake. And to think that that little area is not, and you do something to that little area, it might solve that problem. But what problems is it solving outside here? Or maybe it is solutions. And how can we do that? Gravel is my biggest problem with the bathrooms, because once you put gravel down, you've created a dead surface. The lake, even though it was dry, was beautiful. It changed colors. It was different every time you went by it. And it created a really magnificent scenery because it had different levels of water in it and everything. But you put gravel down, it looks, it never changes. It's dead. Nothing is going to happen to it. You use different colors of gravel and you'll see lines of different colors. It wasn't implemented as good as it could be or followed. But the worst thing about the gravel is on the mountains on the east side of the lake, they tore down mountains and made a big hole in the ground. This was supposed to be behind the mountain so you couldn't see it. Now it's just a big old hole in the ground you could see from the highway. This is also creates another dust area. Nobody's saying anything about that, and it's changing our landscapes. That's why I have such a big problem with gravel. Managed veg is a good solution. I wonder when I sit here and think they're doing all these shrub studies, why don't they just go out there and look at the vegetation that's there? Why do you have to do it in a wind tunnel? You know, there is vegetation there when they don't rip it up. And wind doesn't always come from one direction. That's been the problem with the projects out there. They assume the prevailing wind direction. It comes from all directions, and they're not always the same, and create different problems. The same with shallow flooding. They grade the whole thing to get it as flat as they can to use the lowest amount of water they can. And water's good. Put water on there. One thing, shallow flooding has brought back some of the plants that we couldn't find that were gone. And so water is probably the answer, you know, but that's the problem is they're all destructive. Is there a way that we can do this without being so destructive? But the management, as far as it goes, we talk about percent cover and all this. And what we're seeing is when you implement a backup in this area, like shallow flood, that water doesn't stay in that area, right? So we had another issue where another dust control area, because these areas were designated a long time ago. And because one sensor at the south end of this huge area created some warning signals, they mandated that this whole area be, and they said that we're going to put it all in gravel. So what happened in the years it took between that time that the gravel was going to be put down, the water from the shallow flood area seeped out under the berms into this area and caused, what was it, 14 acres of grass to grow along an old shoreline, the salt grass that creeped in. And we're like, why are you putting gravel, which is a temporary measure, over vegetation, which is a permanent solution to the dust? And so everybody looked at it for a long time. And the final response, to make a long story short, was we talked about these percentages. The percentage of cover for vegetation has to be 37%, and it was only 33-34%. So they couldn't do it. And I started asking, why is it there? Where did that number come from? because when they did the farm on the south end and planted all that south top grass, they noticed that at 25%, the dust quit. So they said, well, why do we have to do 50% if 25% is doing the solution? Okay, well, we'll change this, but we'll just add on another half, and that's where 37% came from. So, you know, arbitrary numbers may work in the lab. They may work with legal terms. They don't work in the real world, okay? Do what needs to be done. And it's the same thing with, if you're going to put shallow flood here, don't say we're going to do this right here. Give it time. We, as part of the Cultural Resources Task Force, we were given, that was the first time the tribes were ever given the opportunity to provide recommendations on what we would like to see happen on the lake. And it was good, but they were still only recommendations. And everyone, we say, give it time. You did this. Yeah, this might have been emissive before. Is it still going to be emissive? And so we did get, you know, they listened somewhat. But it's all still arbitrary, and it can all still be mandated to be mitigated and created. And so I'm just asking to look at, well, there are several issues that have come up, because they talk about average rainfall, average, you know, moisture. What's the baseline? You know, if you look at today, the baseline is pretty sad. But you look at in our days, you know, with our families, you know, have been there for, there was so much water in that valley. So why are we going off of today when they're talking about groundwater pumping? Oh, let's see if we have an effect. You've already had an effect. You know, so that when you design any or think of any new backums, please think about working with the effects that this has already had. Is there any way we can fix it and go back? And my main thing is, why aren't we helping the lake heal itself? This is a natural process of every lake that dries out goes through this, but normally they can fix themselves. They're not as big a dust problem, and they will find ways to fix themselves. How can we help that so that we can go help the lake and then walk away and it's taken care of? So I just ask that you keep that in mind and everything. And there's a whole lot of other issues, you know, in the waste management and dust control is done on the lake, but I'm not going to get into all of that. But I'm glad Jennifer brought that up, because, you know, we have a lot of knowledge. We didn't just live on the land and wander around looking for what we could find to eat and everything. No, we managed that land for thousands of years. We have traditional knowledge. We have knowledge on how these lands need to be managed. And if you combine that knowledge with the science that you guys have, that would equal a solution. So have that for a formula. But I really thank you guys for coming and listening. But I just can't stress enough that you guys really need to come and see the Owens Lake, because it's obvious, you know, from your questions and everything, that's the big stumbling block here. So before you get any farther, you come up there, we welcome you to Nuuanu'u lands, and I'll gladly take you around and show you, answer any questions, because that's where you're going to come up with the answers when you really see what's out there. Thank you.
Thank you. Questions?
I have a question. Thank you for coming, Kathy. I have a question for you, which is, you talked about the lake healing itself, and you also touched on the managed vegetation, shallow flooding is good. So obviously the dust was a problem for you guys. So how do you think that timeline for the lake sort of healing itself combines with some of the solutions that you think work for this? And natural processes that needs to happen.
Natural processes are going to take longer. They're not instant solutions. But you could do instant, not solutions, but help it, you know, to get better. You're not going to have 100% by tomorrow. But you've got a lot already out there. So let's work on the areas that, and that's what we're doing. And the Great Basin and DWP and state lands have been really open, because we are doing some projects where they're tribally driven, and we're doing that in these environmentally sensitive areas because they have the possibility of becoming admissive. And I don't think anybody wants to go to court to tell you whether the protecting resources or the Clean Air Act are more important. So we've been working together to find ways to, alternative ways that aren't so invasive and destructive to help at least slow down the process of emissions and maybe turn it around, you know?
Well, my question was going to be, you mentioned that you'd made a number of recommendations for what should be done on the lake. Could you share those with us and in written form or some?
Yeah, we had the Cultural Resources Task Force was formed as a result of the 2013 SIP, and we've been meeting ever since that. And for phase 7A and for phase 9 and 10, the tribe submitted written recommendations.
Yeah, if you could share those with us.
I'm sure those are available from anybody. So, yeah, I don't mind sharing them because they do really explain where we're coming from. And it's a whole different angle than people are used to looking at a project like this. And I think it opens some people's eyes that there are other solutions. Our number one thing is wait and see what these mitigation measures that you've done are going to result in. Because a lot of them, it's the same thing on the lake. Everything's different because in some of them, if you put a bunch of water here, it's going to spread out and resolve dust issues here. Other places at the south end where they put water in some places, it's actually made the dust worse next to it. So that's where you need the science to say, what is it that causes that, you know? So we need to work together because it is a complicated, like they've been saying, issue. And I'd be glad to help, but I'm sure everybody else would, you know, any way we can.
Kathy, I'm willing to forward this information to them, the TRTF recommendation, because I want to make sure that there's no confidential information in there that you would not be comfortable with me sharing. So maybe we should talk.
Yeah. We should talk about that because off the top of my head, I can't think of anything confidential or we wouldn't have shared it with the whole CRTF. But it should be up to the tribes to determine whether that information should go out. And it is sensitive just because it identifies areas that are important to us. And that's one thing I've gone through with this project and said, you know, there's a reason that these areas are sensitive. There's a reason cultural resources are out there. And that's because people couldn't get out there. And now you're building roads out to them. So we have big problems with looters and everything up there. And so we really have to be careful with identifying those areas. So those aren't the, it's really scary. So that is an issue, but maybe you could get a redacted version.
Thank you.
I have a question.
Yes?
You did express your distaste for gravel. But are you okay with tilling the land as one of the backup?
Tillage is really ugly, but tillage usually happens in places where there was shallow flood, so there isn't a whole lot there left to destroy. So if it's done in small areas, I don't have a problem with it. It's not a final solution because it breaks down. And it would be better to implement a measure there that, like I said, would heal the land, so they didn't have to keep doing it. I've seen them tear down vegetated dunes to build the berm roads. I mean, those vegetated dunes were never going to become emissive, but they needed the soils to build berm roads. And berm roads are fine as long as they water them. And they always talk about in perpetuity. I said, if you're going to have water trucks on those berm roads in perpetuity, then that's fine. But one day, you're not going to be out here to water those roads. And when those fall apart, you're going to have way bigger problems than you had. So that's what, you know, if you're creating a high maintenance project from what was low maintenance and would have eventually healed itself.
Any final questions? Well, thank you very much.
Thank you.
So our final speaker of the day is going to be Danelle Gutierrez from the Tribal Historic Preservation Office from the Big Pine Paiute Tribe.
Anahu, New Tobawahavi, New Mahupi, Tobawahamatawanu Kimadu, Ibia Kudurika U Kimadu, Inawa, Tobawahama to Unu Kimadu. Inanyane Zinalbe Kakateras. I'm just letting you know that I come from Big Pine and I'm about 50, 55 miles north of Pasiata on Lake. And I mentioned in my introduction, my mom, she's Kutsirika from Mona Lake area. And my father, he is Tobawahamatu from Big Pine. And that's who our traditional names are within our areas. I'd like to thank Kathy for all her hard work out there on Pasiata on the Owens Lake, her and her culture monitors, you know, protecting what's out there. I'm part of the CRTF group. And as a Tribal Historic Preservation Officer of the Big Pine Paiute Tribe of the Owens Valley, I would like to thank you for the invite to discuss key issues and important sources with the Owens Lake Scientific Advisory Panel and share cultural information to further assist you in understanding the land of the Pasiata Owens Lake. So it can be included in the evaluation of thinking of new ways to achieve effectiveness and ongoing dust control methods to reduce the airborne particulate matter, and also a tribal perspective concerning the reduction in the use of water in attempts to control dust emissions. Pasiata is a sacred lake. To this day, it is still symbolic to Native people from everywhere. It still has pu'a power and is showing her anger by producing dust that will make people sick as they are making her sick. She will continue to do so until people wake up and realize all she needs is want. Her life back, her water. Prayers and offerings are still made in hopes of Pasiata to become as it once was. It was honored and respected like all streams, creeks, rivers, and lakes are, as they provide life and life surrounded these waterways, as determined in your archaeological and anthropology and paleontology studies. Numa people were taught to take care of the land, so in turn it would take care of us. We irrigated, planted, and worked with the land to help us endure our way of life for thousands and thousands of years since time immemorial. We knew we had to keep the land's air and water in balance because if it got sick, we would get sick. This is the natural teaching of our ways. As this issue of Pasiata and the dust emissions is showing you, all the waterways from the land of the Kutsirika people in Mona Lake and the river streams, creeks from up that way, coming down to Paiute-Shoshone, Owens Valley, even the glacier water from Tobawahamatu land, Big Pine, all the water travels and rests in Pasiata, Owens Lake. In our language and that of the Kutsirika and other tribes, we have names for all these places. We have histories of these areas and of dry creek beds that were dug into so water can flow again and water the land. Many of the lands had to be watered in order for all to live, people, wildlife, vegetation. It is in this part of sharing that our tribe requests the Owens Lake Science Advisory Panel to look into the choice of releasing additional flows of our natural precipitation that is brought from rains and snowmelt to be allowed to flow in their original waterways, such as creeks, so the valley's water tables can be replenished. It is only a matter of time when your panel will be obligated to meet in the future to analyze other dust emission situations in other locations within the Inyo and Mono counties. If portions of water was to be allowed to fill Pasiata Owens Lake to a certain percentage or level, as is done to Mona Lake, that would assist in resolving the issue and save LADWP millions of dollars, in which they could utilize that money to assist Los Angeles in becoming self-sufficient in their water usage, to provide solar energy to the city of Los Angeles on the rooftops instead of depleting resources from the own valley with underground pumping and surface water export. The Big Pine Paiute Tribe acknowledges that during the past 20 years, progress has been made to reduce airborne PM10 in an effort to bring in the Owens Valley into compliance of the Clean Air Act. It is also known that the drying of the lake resulted in Paiute becoming the single largest emitter of PM10 in the nation, and the dust being a threat to human health for years. LADWP has applied various dust abatement measures on the lake bed. Their efforts were treated as projects under CEQA were applied to take and were applied to the lake beds in phases. The tribe mourns the destruction of Paiute and ancestors and relatives that use the lake and shores for many purposes. Tribal people have long known what the archaeologists are now seeing, a long chronology of humans using resources of this once vast, dynamic inland sea. The dust mitigation measures approved by Great Basin Unified Air Pollution Control District and undertaken by LADWP have resulted in a huge amount of ground disturbance. Artifacts and numerous culture sites have been disrupted or destroyed due to these activities. Existing environmental laws and policies apparently allow the Owens Lake Dust Control Project to be implemented in phases, in which the tribes disagree because this approach made it impossible to see the over-impact to the integrity of culture and other resources associated with Owens Lake. Archaeologists hired to survey the dust control footprint areas prior to construction, viewed only these arbitrary areas. As one phase of dust mitigation led to another, a larger view of tribal use emerged, and with it the realization that sites previously regarded as insignificant or eligible for the National California Register of Historic Resources were destroyed before they were seen in their true context. At Owens Lake and in Owens Valley, tribes have lost physical links to our ancestors' way of life and places of significance to our culture, like Paiute. We only have stories of how that lake once was. Like Kathy mentioned, the birds, they're so abundant, life was so plentiful, our history and our resources out there, you know, that we're out there, if they're not looted, you know, shows the strength of that lake and the power and the ecological contributions that it made to life of everything from insects, from the tiniest of insects to the tallest creatures that still walk. And the dust control efforts at Owens Lake also failed to consider the impacts to the Eastern Sierra's limited water resources. LADWP releases some water to control dust on the lake bed, but continues to export surface water and pump groundwater from Owens Valley. Owens Valley is climatically and a hydrologically closed basin, and Owens Lake was a naturally terminal lake. Constantly draining water from this valley and its lake to export to a wetter region of the state has taken a toll and will continue to cause the environmental demise of the tribe's ancestral home and that of Owens Valley. This project of LADWP taking water from the valley has never been adequately addressed. As LADWP's project of water export continues, many parts of Owens Valley are experiencing vegetation die-off, and as a result, increased fugitive dust emissions. One effective LADWP dust control measure is to apply water to the shallow flood mitigation area. But it's important to understand that this activity puts added strain on Owens Valley. LADWP pumps water from places like the Pit Pine area in order to provide the water to mitigate the dust. Alley is not paying the price of mitigating Owens Lake dust. Instead, communities like Big Pine are paying the price. The tribe is concerned that the ongoing dewatering throughout the valley causes the particulate matter emission problems to be transferred from the lake bed, which is being addressed, to other parts of the valley where dust emissions are not monitored, but we see it. The tribe holds the position that the best solution for controlling PM10 in Owens Valley for now in the future is to refill Owens Lake with natural surface water and to restore hydrologic integrity throughout the valley. Had tribes been consulted in the initiation of LADWP's dewatering project, The tribe would have made it clear that it's unthinkable to the tribe that humans would be allowed to deprive Owens Lake of the water. Yet this is what happened in a very short time period, as her grandparents and great-grandparents witnessed. Predictably, the abrupt desiccation was allowed, was followed by ecological devastation and horrific dust storm conditions which may have been endured by our people and others. The CRTF was formed to address cultural resources affected by the dust control efforts and make recommendations on protection. The formation of the CRTF is an attempt to protect what remains to pursue it. Adequate mitigation, and the tribe would like to see the CRTF continue and expand beyond just the lake with regard to resource protection for all humans and wildlife. And as Cassie also mentioned, you know, the areas around the lake too is starting to show signs of dust emissions. It's nice that there's a portion of the lake that's for the shorebirds, and that's important. However, it is still limited action to a larger environmental issue. And earlier I mentioned Mona Lake and how water levels should be established to Owens Lake too, even though there is an agreement for Mona Lake. It is also experiencing ecological damage and causing public concern. And I don't think anybody wants it to turn out like Owens Lake. History will respect its history, will repeat itself if lessons are not learned. We need to make viable changes to protect our planet and all of its inhabitants. You can conduct all your scientific studies and spend millions of dollars to keep Paiute-Shoshone Lake free of dust emissions. The only thing that will fix this is simply let the lake be a lake and let the water back in and on it. And I believe she has festered enough. Also, the people of Owens Valley, too. Why not? Thank you.
Thank you. Questions? Thank you very much. And I'd like to thank all of the participants in the session today. My understanding is that we have no request for public comment. So with that, having no public comments on the last bit of our agenda, yes.
Can I say one more real quick? Just briefly?
Please, certainly we can.
I'm Donna Nay Charlevoix. I'm the Mona Lake Preservation Tribal Chairperson.
Could you go to the microphone? If you go to the microphone, the people can hear it.
Glad. I'm Charlotte Lang. I'm the Mona Lake Kuzivika Tribal Chairperson, and I was invited by my infant sisters to partake in this meeting today, and it's quite important. We have quite a bit of education, scientists, wonderful people that are going to be making some decisions for us, and we're really being our lands are really being torn apart by people not thinking outside the box. All these formulas are great. Land flux equals H2O. I kind of remember that in chemistry. Water is life, and that is us. I encourage you to come up to the valley and drive up. But first, look at the pictures before. Our valley was gorgeous. And our shrubs are dying. Our plants, I mean, you're seeing more spaces. You're seeing them turn into tumbleweeds and they're flowing away. It's like an old western, and it's really disheartening. Up in our land, DWP is planning on drilling 20 test wells. Well, they're going to do that to the headwaters where we're at. It's not going to take us long to start looking like the valley. And I am currently a homeowner in Big Pine, and I see our water rights depleting just as a homeowner, and it's really devastating. So when you're really thinking, and I've seen you being taking notes about what Kathy and Danielle have said, which is my niece, but she speaks from the heart. Kathy speaks from a perspective of really knowing chemistry. So we have to come to Kathy and like, well, what does this mean now? But I just would like you to think through your heart as our perspective, how much we have endured in destruction of, we are here way before any of you. And please think of us as you, as our family, and how would you feel in your land being destroyed? Because pretty soon we're not going to have any land. Our grandchildren, your grandchildren, we're all going to not have some place beautiful to share. So please, when you take it in your heart and you're really looking at these issues, think of us and yourself. Thank you.
Thank you. Any other requests for public comment? Any further comments from the panel? Okay, with that, we're officially adjourned.